to pretend that they're not reading it from the teleprompter. I've been on television for 15 years. We're all taught to look at our papers on occasion as if we're not seeing the words in front of us. I think Sapphire was absolutely right in regard to his criticism of the way in which the anti-Bork senators have done their job. It has been shoddy, and it has been theatrical, and it hasn't been substantive. It hasn't had guts to it. Right. Where I think he errs, because we differ on the conclusion, is on whether Judge Bork should or should not be confirmed. Mr. Sapphire feels he should. I feel that Judge Bork should not be confirmed. Yeah. But I love Sapphire's reasoning powers, and I thought, I am not an enemy of Senator Kennedy, but I know that Senator Kennedy falls apart if you give him something he hasn't been prepped on. He is not an on-his-feet thinker type. This is not his strength. And,
well,
boy, this is showing it.
Right. Well, probably this is my weakness, talking to a talk show host of your caliber. I would probably fall into Teddy's corner there. Mm-hmm. However, on thought preparation and so on, and I used to be a manager with a international corporation. I've spoke at seminars and so on. And as far as Biden is concerned, and I'm getting off the subject, but I don't know of anybody who has ever made a public presentation that didn't pick something up from something good that somebody said, whether it was 5 years, 10 years, or 100 years before, and inserted it into his speech to make a point that probably was made better than what he could do himself.
I agree entirely.
You emphasize, like I think earlier in the program, if you try to convey the message that I was thinking when I was traveling on the train or the commuter or whatever it is, that it was your thought, this is totally wrong. But it's such a fine line. It's like between love and hate.
A way to have said it is, as I was traveling on the train, a thought came to mind,
right,
which I borrowed from someone else. There's ways to do. All he did, as far as I can tell, Senator Biden, was step one inch farther over the line than most of them do, and he could have saved that day simply by saying some lines by a fellow politician in Britain reminded me of my own circumstance in life, like Neil Kinnock, of whom none of you has ever heard. I too am a first-time college boy, or whatever. I mean, there's ways to do that. He did it awkwardly, but I can't get worked up about him because, as you point out, the borrowing is a tribute, in a sense, to the wisdom, or at least to the verbal acuity of our forefathers, or at least people who preceded us.
Why, of course. I said to my niece and nephew many years ago, I have no idea if they've done it, but they were in their teens and the impressionable age, and I suggested to them very casually, they probably did not take it seriously, I says, pick 10 subjects, your own, I won't dictate them to you, write down your opinion against each one. Alright, this is in the teens. Mid-20s, use the same 10 subjects, write down your opinion, your concepts of it.
Uh-huh.
And do the same thing in your 30s. Then when you break the over-the-hill point at 40, open up all of these and see if your positions have changed in the least from what you thought when you were 15, 16, 17, or 18.
Boy, what a wonderful idea. You know, it reminds me, when I was in college, one of my roommates and another friend of ours, we thought that we were sort of Plato and Socrates, and we decided to solve all the problems of religion and philosophy. And so we, during the summer vacation, we started writing a journal. I would write in it, then it would go to one of the others, then he would write it and go to the third one, and we sent it back. For some reason, I wound up with them, and the other day I was reading them, and I thought, oh, please let these never fall into the hands of my enemies. I'm going to move on, sir. Thank you for the call.
Very good.
Thank you very much. Bye-bye. This is WBZ. I have a beautiful letter I want to read to you right at this point. As I said before, letters of the day will depend upon them, their being relevant to either something that's come before us or suggestive of something to come before us, or just strong and intelligently critical of me or something else that is of general interest. This is a really nice one. It will just take a few minutes, but it's nice. It's from South Boston, from a lady. Dear Dave, you mentioned that you are puzzled why the crime rate was so low during the Depression. I grew up during those years, and it has made an impression that has never left me. I remember the day my father came home and told us he received his last paycheck. He always worked steady, but at a low-paying job. We were poor, and now we were going to be poorer. For 7 long years, we struggled to stay together. A day's work was all we could get. We never rode even for 10 cents. It would be used toward bread. No one ever stole because we were all in the same position. We walked the streets day and night without fear. There were no huge minorities around like now ready to pounce on you. No one locked doors, had pet purses snatched or assaulted in any way. Families pooled what they had and tried to help each other. An uncle who got a day's pay cried his own expenses, helped his, helped his married brother's family to buy food. There were no food stamps or handouts. The churches would tell you to go to the welfare. This was the last resort, as it meant you were a pauper. $12 a week was allotted to a family of 5, and a worker could come at any time, unannounced, to see if you really had nothing. They would open your icebox, and God help you if you even had 1/2 pound of butter. You were dropped from the rolls without a hearing. We wore used clothes from a cousin whose father worked for the old Boston L. At Christmas, we would walk into town and look at the gifts we couldn't buy. We had no tree or lights, but went to a relative's home for Christmas. We never stole, because it was drilled into us, any time you didn't pay for you had no right to touch. Anything you didn't pay for, you had no right to touch. This poverty was a cross we had to bear until things changed. It was the morals of all of us, but never weakened. You accepted your lot, and you did your best. I didn't know how poor we were until a graduation, when I bought a $3 dress, and Aunt bought my underwear, and I had to borrow a pair of shoes to go to accept my diploma. No prom, no yearbook or pictures. Then the prospect of no job, as we had no pull anywhere. As bad as it was then, I had youth and hope. Now I am elderly. You can't go in town without fear of being robbed, sit in the park or enjoy the little pleasures anymore. Some predator is ready to leap on you if you walk slowly and have a cane. You know, David, the people of those days held the country together. We were proud to be Americans. We should have rioted like the others did and demanded our rights. I see the people from other countries flooding in here and being given benefits they never earned. Those of us at that time are at the end of our lives. I'm still struggling. Added to the trouble, we have health problems. We can't take off because medical costs have skyrocketed. The newly arrived from all over the globe are given free care, housing, and benefits we should have. Sooner or later, our apartment will be gone, and then what? It was the greatest country in the world, but no more. If I was younger, I would go anywhere to get away from it. It sure has let us down. Enjoy your program. We agree on most everything. I like your etc. Nice remarks from her. Very interesting letter. I think very sincere. I rarely make a mistake on that much. I think people tend to write the truth as they see it. I think it's a remarkably frank letter. She's not softening anything. All right, let's move ahead. If you have some thoughts about that kind of letter, I will read on occasion. Unless somebody says I may not, I will. If you don't want a letter ever written there, just say, don't read it, period, and I won't. Don, good evening.
Hello, I'm Dave.
Yes, sir. Hi.
I'd like to talk about, make a few comments about the Bork hearings.
Yes.
I've spent a good deal of time listening to NPR's broadcast of them, and I figure 35 hours has been on. I've listened to at least 20.
Oh, you're a masochist, I
so
see.
I think that in some small way, maybe I'm slightly qualified to make a few remarks.
Sure,
even
sure,
though maybe totally wrong.
Yeah.
And one of the remarks I want to make is, personally, I oppose Bork's nomination, but I grind my teeth and clench my fists every time I listen to the liberal members of the House Senate Judiciary Committee, because I think their attacks or arguments against have been all wrong. Bork has gone there, and he's been given very well-crafted arguments and very raised the level of the hearings at a very cerebral level, and yet they continue to call on the charges that he will roll back the country to the judicial stone age, and the rhetoric continues on and on.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the problem is that Bork does have some real holes in his argument. One of the things I think that they should be looking at, and some, I hope some of the witnesses bring this up, is that, well, the conservatives continually harp on the fact that, for instance, Bork upheld a number of civil rights cases or overturned lower courts on civil rights cases when he was sitting on the D.C. Circuit. I don't think it's been looked into, and I may be wrong in this, but I have a distinct feeling that many of those cases were ones in which the answer was so obvious that if Bork had decided the other way, he would be branded as someone who was not in step with the rest of the country as far as civil rights is concerned. But no one looks into that.
Nobody has thus far. There will be testimony from the American Bar Association, from the civil liberties unions, from women's groups, black groups, from conservative groups. Somebody's, unless they're complete fools, will bring up that. Surely, I hope the supporters of Judge Bork realize that the upholding of all his rulings doesn't mean that each was a dramatic, new, brilliant venture, and the Supreme Court said, oh my God, wow, isn't this hot? No, much of it was patently obvious for a sane, civilized judge to rule that way, and so on. Some, I think, will indicate the direction of the country, the direction of courts in general, but not all, and I certainly haven't read all his rulings.
Right.
Go ahead, I'm sorry.
I just wanted to mention one thing, just as a brief example, and I'll try to get off so I can don't hog up all your time. But there was one case that especially Orrin Hatch cited a number of occasions when any of the other senators had looked into Bork's standing on free speech, and that was the business on the Washington Metro, and a man, an artist, put up some posters, or wanted to put up some posters, rent space on the subway and put up posters that depicted, had a picture of Reagan laughing and with his advisors and pointing, and then he put a totally separate picture next to it of some poor people. And Bork upheld the right of this man to put up this poster, to rent the space and put up these posters,
mm-hmm.
and it's been lauded as an example of his belief in the broad interpretation of the First Amendment. In my opinion, that some of his critics should say, well, any judge who would strike down this man's right to do that would have such a incredibly narrow interpretation of the First Amendment that everyone in the mainstream, conservative and liberal alike, would feel this judge was totally out of step. But no one looks into that. His critics should continue harping on the same things instead of taking, I think, sort of the cerebral approach and picking apart his argument on the same level that he's presenting it to show the flaws in it.
Yeah, you know, it seems to me that the committee staff work in the contra-Iran hearings was far brighter. Whatever side you came down on in terms of Poindexter and North and Secord and so on, I would say that on both sides there were some really sharp, interesting pieces of idea put forward by the staff. I mean, most senators are idiots. As far as I'm concerned, most politicians are the scum of the earth. I'm not keen on them, so I'm not going to glorify them, liberal or conservative alike, but at least they can hire bright young men and women to work for them. In this case, it seems to me they must have hired their brothers-in-law or something. I mean, who is preparing this junk for Kennedy? I can't imagine. I mean, Kennedy is renowned as having the best staff in Congress of all the ordinary senators, that is, those who are not the leader of the Senate. And I don't see it. I don't see him doing this sort of thing, which would be to lead the judge along a reasoned path of argument in some area of significance so that we learn from the judge what he believes and from the senator what the judge has written and done. I mean, that's the fair way to do it. And I couldn't agree with you more, Don, that what we're getting here is a lot of posturing on it. As an example, the judge's remark that now he allows free speech to include the advocacy of overthrowing law is an interesting change. The question might be, why didn't you believe it before, and what made you change your mind now? That's interesting.
The Brandenburg case.
Yeah, that's exactly. You got it.
Could I just make one quick remark as far as that's concerned? I think that despite the charges of a confirmation conversion, I think that many of Bork's changes are indeed sincere and are not manufactured or made so that he can get into the Supreme Court. But I think you have to look that the reason he made those decisions to begin with were on legal technicalities, and he's changed them because he's looking at the technical construction of the Constitution differently. And I think he's a legal technocrat, and he's changed the way he looks at it. But I don't think that he has the really strong or underlying values. I think they've just been a change in the way he looks at the mechanics of the thing. And it may be valid, and he's got a very well-crafted argument, but I just wonder where those solid underlying values are, because I don't think they're there.
Don, you know, one thought comes to me. If I were a senator at the moment, I think I would vote against his work, but I remember when Theodore Coop was appointed Surgeon General. Lord, another one of those people. Oh, one of those crazy people that Jerry Falwell and Phyllis Schlafly will be adoring. Interestingly enough, Theodore Coop has turned out to be an advocate of the people's health. He has not turned out to be a propagandist for his political ideology. He's a devout and sincere fundamentalist, born-again Christian right-winger. He has acted as the people's doctor, meaning in favor of all of our health. I've been rather amazed by how unfearsome Theodore Coop has turned out to be. He's been, I think, from the perspective, as I said, nobody should be under any doubt about me. I want in government the least damage to the individual. And it seems to me Theodore Coop has been a great friend of all of ours. And who knows, Judge Bork, if confirmed, might turn out to be one of the great towering defenders of individualism in the history of the court. I doubt it, but who knows? If you'd asked me about Theodore Coop a few years ago, I would have said the man is a crackpot.
Yes.
You know, because his defenders included people I abhor, like Phyllis Schlafly and the crazies on the right. But, so who knows?
Well.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. This is WBZ. I'm David Brudnoy. Let's take a brief commercial break. We'll take more calls after this. Everything from paper clips to microchips, that is what you will find at Officeland. Officeland has a complete line of office supplies, office furniture, personal computers, and accessories. At Officeland, you'll find courteous and knowledgeable salespeople who will help you find everything you want, from the right size envelope to an Officeland brand personal computer, and delivered to you with discounts of up to 50%. Each Officeland location offers free delivery, no minimum order, and welcomes small business accounts. For a free consultation, ask Officeland to call on your business to demonstrate how Officeland can save you money. With 9 stores serving eastern New England, you'll find Officeland in Massachusetts in Auburn, Boxborough, Lowell, Mansfield, Northborough, Wilbraham, and Pocasset on the Cape, and New Hampshire, in Manchester and Nashua. Drop in and see them soon or call area code 617-481-6300. They'll give you the nearest location to you.
Hey, you know, these days, it seems easier to get into Harvard than to get an appointment to have your oil changed. Well, if you've had enough of 3-week appointments and all-day oil changes, do what I do. Say enough already and drive into your nearest Jiffy Lube. Don't call ahead. Don't plan to take a day off from work. Just drive into Jiffy Lube when you've got a few minutes to spare. In just 10 of those minutes, they'll change your oil with Pennzoil, install a new Purolator oil filter, lubricate the chassis. Hey, they'll check and top off all vital fluids, check your air filter, pump up your tires. They'll even vacuum the car and wash your windshield. 14 essential services in just 10 minutes at your convenience. Almost sounds too good to be true, but it is true. And Jiffy Lube meets all requirements for maintaining new car warranties. So, if you think about it, the only people who shouldn't use Jiffy Lube are those who have a lot of time to kill.
Jiffy Lube will give your car 14-point perfection for only $23.95. Visit the Jiffy Lube nearest you in Beverly, Braintree, Brockton, Haverhill, Hyannis, Marlboro, Norwell, or Reading.
It's been a quiet campaign so far, but for a lot of Boston political candidates, it's now or never. Today is Boston's preliminary election. There are four candidates for mayor, dozens for school committee and city council. WBZ Radio News will be right on top of it with updates on voting throughout the day. When the results come in tonight, WBZ News will be live from City Hall with updates every half hour. Boston's preliminary election, another reason why you need WBZ News two, three, four times a day.
WBZ Boston.
WBZ time, 12:48. Easy AccuWeather forecast for Roy Gallant. Saying tonight, cloudy, the low in the mid-50s. Later on, possibly a sunny start, but becoming cloudy, the high about 70 degrees. Tuesday evening, cloudy with showers, maybe a thunderstorm, the low approximately 55 degrees. And on Wednesday, a mixture of sun and clouds, the high about 70. Currently in Boston, 55 degrees. Bob, good evening. Thank you for calling, sir.
Hi.
Hi, how are you?
Bob from Gloucester.
Yes, Bob from Gloucester. How are you?
Hi, good.
What's up tonight, sir?
Recently, 12 years ago, I moved from Charlestown. And two calls ago, you had a litter. You read a litter.
Yes.
It had to be from Charlestown or Southie.
The lady was from South Boston, yes.
All right.
Yes.
And it could have just as well have been from East Boston on the north end.
Mm-hmm. I agree. It could have been from any of the older and more traditional neighborhoods, yes.
Ethnic.
Yes. It could have been. It could have been, I think so.
The litter moved me, you know?
Me too. Believe me, that's what I read.
And I moved to Gloucester 12 years ago, and when you move there, but you're still from the old town, you know?
Sure.
And all I want to say is the litter moved me.
Yeah. I don't know what your age is, sir, but the lady had gone through the Depression, obviously, so I presume she's in her 60s or 70s, somewhere
like
that.
I'm only 52.
All right, well, then you remember as a little tiny kid some of the
30s. I remember going to the welfare and fire stations and stuff, you know, you can get the milk for nothing and that's it, you know?
Yes.
But everything we did there was, you never had your door locked. Today you gotta have a machine gun.
Almost. Almost. Yeah, I remember too growing up, even in the early, mid-40s, it seems to me I recall that we never locked the door when we were home.
Right.
Rarely locked the door when we just went out to visit the neighbors. And it was just not thought of. Never. Nobody would ever have a robbery, anything of the sort, ever. And we lived in a very sort of ordinary neighborhood. It was not fancy schmancy, as my mother would have put it. Well, I'm glad you liked the letter. I will read them when they touch something of importance. I think that one touches a certain emotional nerve in a lot of people.
Idea.
Thank you for calling, sir.
You're welcome.
Thank you very much. Our number 254-5678, the area code here is 617. We have a little time for a few more calls. Let's do a couple. Phyllis, good evening.
Hi.
Hi, Phyllis.
I listen to you frequently, David.
Yes, ma'am.
Did you see the latest, it's October Yankee?
I didn't see the October Yankee yet, ma'am. No, I get Yankee, but I haven't seen that
well,
one. Probably will come in.
Well, 14 years after the massacre, it's on Archibald Cox.
Oh.
And on the page after you start, there's a picture, and under the picture it says Robert Burke, who fired Cox in 1973, has been nominated to the Supreme Court, and that's a picture of both of them.
Uh-huh.
And I read the article kind of, in a hurry, but evidently Cox had worked a lot for President Kennedy.
Oh, yeah.
So I wondered if there was some implication here that because he had worked on Watergate and all, then Burke had if it was political.
No, Burke was the third person asked by President Nixon to fire the special prosecutor. If you recall, he asked the Attorney General, Elliot Richardson, who said no. And he asked one other person, whose name escapes me at the moment, but I should know it well. He said no. And Bork, who was at that point Solicitor General, I believe, which is a high government post, finally took and did what he was asked to do by President Nixon. It was not political in the sense of being Republican versus Democrat or liberal versus conservative, or the other way around. It was a matter of Bork's reading of presidential rights. Included the right of the president to fire Mr. Cox, who was the other prosecutor at that point.
But he seems, from this article, Archibald Cox seems like a very upstanding lawyer.
Oh, he is. He
and
is.
A very conservative person that would really have wanted the Constitution to be upheld.
Yeah, so I think many people did. There was an interview in the Globe yesterday with him in the Sunday magazine, and Peter Mead had Mr. Cox on about a week ago, and Mr. Cox refused to answer any questions about Bork, feeling that he, because he had a personal relationship with Bork, he did not want to intrude his views into the public sphere, and which is an example of standing. He could have probably turned a little knife into Bork if he wanted to.
Yeah.
But he did not.
I think he's upstanding.
Yeah.
But I didn't know whether you had read that or not, but it's a nice article, so
uh-huh.
if you get a chance, read it.
Well, right. Okay, thank
and
you.
And I grew up during the Depression, too. I'll be 70 years old in December,
uh-huh.
and I remember, you know, quite a few things, but I don't think I ever remember being hungry.
Well, that's a step in the right direction. Yeah, some people did. I think the lady who wrote was probably writing exactly what her own experiences in life had been.
That's possible.
And I think that that's a useful thing. You can't do much better than get true-to-life experiences phrased very straightforwardly like that. There's no gloss. There's no sugarcoating. It's just the way she remembers it and the way she evaluates it now.
And I still think this country's the best.
Well, I don't know any that...
I was born in Canada. I was born in Canada.
You were. Well, you're good neighbors. Okay, thank
All
you,
right.
man. Thank you
Bye-bye.
For the call. This is WBZ. I'm David Brudnoy. Our number is 254-5678. Just a little bit on this matter that came up earlier with Peter and me. We were talking about the quotations stuff. I don't know if the issue will ever be put to bed until Biden screams uncle. I quoted before the remark of Daniel Webster in 1830, who referred to people's government made for the people, made by the people, and answerable.